lords and gentlemen. Pray silence for our host, Colonel Burrow. My lords and gentlemen, I confess to some embarrassment upon this occasion, speaking as I do for the first time in public and in the presence of so distinguished a company. I feel greatly honored by your presence here tonight, a company distinctly representative in its character. Her Majesty's Postmaster General, Mr. Cecil Rakes, is here to speak not only for politics in its highest sense, but for that great department over which he so worthily presides, and to whose administrative ability we confidently look for the means of sending innocent phonograms from point to point throughout the world without their being opened or route or being otherwise tampered with by over-inquisitive officials. There is in the association with the name of the Postmaster General, the name of Mr. Edmunds Yates, a peculiar fitness. He having served with distinction for no less than a quarter of a century in the same important department of the public service. In welcoming Mr. Yates at Little Menlo, my English home, for the first time, I feel that I am meeting an old friend, for it was my pleasure and my honor to be one of that vast army of Americans who welcomed him in America now some 20 years ago. Nobody can better answer than Mr. Yates for literature. And who better could answer for music than that distinguished composer, Sir Arthur Sullivan, and to whom the phonograph takes this earliest opportunity of expressing its delight at the great success achieved but a few nights since by that distinguished composer's latest production, The Yeoman of the Guard. Mr. J.C. Parkinson's interest of many years since and his identification with the Atlantic cable make a fit beginning to so appropriate and interesting an end so far as we have gone, as is presented by this latest achievement in connection with it. Mr. Tucker, and I thank you very sincerely for the cordial manner in which you have received the toast just proposed, and for the very kindly expression with which it was accompanied by its proposer. But I confess that in my reply, I am thinking rather of another than of myself. I am thinking of him, that great genius, in whose real honor we have met here tonight, and of whom I am but a feeble shadow in Europe. I am but expressing aloud what I feel must be in the mind of each of you when I say how much I regret that he cannot be here in the flesh as well as he is in the spirit, and as you will presently see in the voice. I thank you in the name of Mr. Edison, first, and then for myself. And in conclusion, I would say that I sincerely trust that this will be but the beginning of many more interesting meetings under similar interesting circumstances. And with your permission, I should like to take this occasion to express my thanks to Mr. Hamilton and his assistants for their able cooperation in preparation of the interesting matter with which we have been entertained and are yet to be. I will now only ask you to drink to the health of Edison. Standing, bumpers, and cheers. Those cheers and any kind words which any of you may like to say to Mr. Edison in response to this toast will be recorded on another instrument in the adjoining room and will be sent to America through the kind agency of Her Majesty. Little Menlo, October the 5th, 1888. Phonogram, Bureau to Edison. Dear Edison, I propose to conclude a most interesting and agreeable evening, so far as I am concerned, by introducing to you a few friends who have honored me this evening by their presence here. Each of them has expressed a desire to say a few words to you, and I am sure you will be glad to hear their voices, as I am glad to be the medium of communicating them to you. Need I say, through your marvelous phonograph. First, the Right Honorable Cecil Rakes, Her Majesty's Postmaster General. Now listen to Mr. Rakes' voice.
We thank you for a most interesting and delightful evening. We feel that you are become inventor of a new magic. We regard this invention as destined almost to revolutionize the means of human communication. And we wish you all success in promoting a discovery which cannot fail to have the most beneficial results for the whole community of nations. Cecil Rakes, Her Majesty's Postmaster General.
I next have the pleasure of introducing to you a name that is as familiar to you and all of our countrymen as it is, I am happy to say, to myself and my family, Mr. Edmund Yeats.
This is the record of a most marvelous dinner, transmitted to you by your most marvelous invention. If I lack words to describe the dinner, it is because I am so enraptured and so enchanted by your invention that I find myself much more stupid than I ought to be after the grand excitement of our friends' meats and wine. Edmund Yeats, not Her Majesty's Postmaster General, but one who was a poor clerk under Our Majesty's Postmaster General for 25 years.
We will now pass on to the next phonogram, which will begin with a record that I am sure you will receive with infinite delight. Knowing your love for music, I need only say that the record will be the voice of the great composer Sir Arthur Sullivan, whose music is as well known in America as it is in England, and as well loved by those who know it. Little Menlo, October 5th, 1888, from Puro to Edison, continuation of Introduction of Friends. Now listen to the voice of Sir Arthur Sullivan.
Dear Mr. Edison, if my friend Edmund Yeats has been a little incoherent, it is in consequence of the excellent dinner, good wine he has done. Therefore, I beg you will excuse him. He has his lucid intervals. myself, I can only say that I am astonished and somewhat terrified at the result of this evening's experiment. Astonished at the wonderful power you have developed, and terrified at the thought that so much hideous dance music may be put on record forever. But all the same, I think it is the most wonderful thing that I have ever experienced, and I congratulate you with all my heart on this wonderful discovery. Arthur Sullivan.
My next introduction is Mr. Broadley, well-known English barrister, whose name will always be remembered by his distinguished defense of Arabi Pasha. Now listen to his voice.
It would be difficult for me to convey to Mr. Edison.
Yeah, Mr. Edison.
It would be very difficult for me to convey to you any idea of the impression which your invention has caused tonight upon the guests who assembled round the hospitable table of Colonel Guru. The mysteries of the East and the mysteries of Egypt pale before an invention which is doubtless destined to effect a revolution in the means of communication throughout the civilized world. I trust that one of the first outcomes of the dinner today will be a safer transmission of your phonographic records to their destination. As I am speaking to you, the Postmaster General is holding a serious consultation with Colonel Goodall upon the subject of the transmission of these records. There is one other subject to which I think the phonograph may be very judiciously applied, and that is as a substitute for the great plethora of after-dinner speaking from which we to some extent suffer in this country. I have had the privilege tonight of officiating as phonographic toastmaster, and when this instrument is introduced for that purpose, I shall claim to be the ancestor of a long line of toastmasters who, instead of discharging their functions in the present manner, have recourse to the phonograph for the expeditious fulfillment of those duties with which in this country we are sufficiently familiar. I can only express my great thanks to Colonel Goodall for giving us the opportunity of witnessing your invention, and express an earnest hope that in the near future we may have again an opportunity of witnessing some further experiments with the phonograph. A.M. Broadley, Barrister at Law.
Our next guest, to whom I will present to you, is Mr. J.C. Parkinson, whose name you will remember as an old telegraphist yourself, as having an early identification with that most important phase of telegraphy, which now goes by the common name of Atlantic cables. Mr. Parkinson will now speak.
It is a great privilege to have taken part this evening in this most interesting celebration. You have heard from our friends previously how deeply we are indebted to our host tonight and to you.
I must apologize, Mr. Parkinson, for leaving him so long in Jamaica, and will now relieve him from his embarrassment by passing on to Mr. Guest Augustus Harry, more popularly known as Augustus Rory Lingers. I confess that I had supposed that Mr. Augustus
sooner or later, thought that there remained to him no more world to conquer. But there can be no doubt that he has set in the launching of the Armada. He has eclipsed all of his previous most brilliant efforts. He has my most sincere congratulations. But his triumph will not be complete unless the good ship Armada finally drops her anchors in American waters. Passing from the drama, we find ourselves where we always do in time, vis-a-vis with the law. In our friend, Mr. Broadley, we have a distinguished representative whose achievements I have not forgotten in connection with that most interesting event known in history as the defense of Araby Pasha. I beg his Pasha's pardon. I should have said Araby Pasha. Our congratulations to Mr. Broadley would be incomplete if we were not to mention his more recent victory in the case of Ismail Pasha, which I hope has been as satisfactory to his pocket as I hear it has been to his science. Mr. Broadley has added to my personal obligations to him in consenting to act tonight as toastmaster, in which role he has again, for the third time, distinguished himself. To say nothing of the distinction he has thus conferred upon the phonograph in giving to it an entirely original and most useful role amongst its many. Hello, the gentlemen. Pray silence for Her Majesty's Postmaster General, the Philanthropist Esquire, Member of Parliament. Charge your glasses, gentlemen. Butlers, if you please. Silence, gentlemen. Silence, if you please. Mr. Edmund Yates.
My lords and gentlemen, being myself a complete failure as an after-dinner speaker, I, better than anyone else, can appreciate the treat which you are about to enjoy in listening to the eloquence of one of England's most famous after-dinner speakers, Mr. Edmund Yates, upon whom the phonograph now calls to speak in response to the toast to literature, which I now ask you to drink.
Gentlemen, the toast is literature, coupled with the name of Mr. Edmund Yates. Charge your glasses, gentlemen. Bumpers, if you please.
Than that which comes from him.
Gentlemen,
Charge your classes, if you please. The toast is music, coupled with the name of Robert Sullivan, Doctor of Laws.
Sir Arthur Sullivan!
Sir Arthur Sullivan!
Your very good health, Sir Arthur!
Sullivan, your health!
It is the health of our host, Colonel Goodall. It has been my privilege during the past 3 or 4 years to see a certain number of celebrities home. And I think you will agree with me that there are very few of these celebrities who can claim surrounding as interesting as those which we see at Little Menlo. We have today assisted at an entertainment which is unique, and you have had the wonderful operation of the instrument which might win great advantage being employed in some of our public meetings. If the day ever does come when a certain number of speeches can be superseded by the action of the phonograph, I think that Colonel Guru and Mr. Edison will have put the public at large very considerably in their case. As it is, it now only remains for me to ask you to show by the manner in which you receive this toast your appreciation of the kindly welcome which has been accorded to all of you in the English home of American fans, in a home which by the beauty and its scenery recalls to Mr. Edison and to Colonel Grow such of the historic features which surround the locality in America where this great invention was fabricated. Gentlemen, fill your glasses. For the last time, I say, butlers, if you please. For the last time, I call on you through the phonograph to drink the health of its pioneer in this country, our kind and genial host, Colonel George Goodall.
Thank you.